down as well. So it's just a great way for the community as a church family to come together. Okay, and that's really what I'm going to look for. I'm also going to try to post this out, try to reach out to our Boy Scouts and get some other groups involved. You know, somewhere along the line, we've lost that community connection. And this is a problem, to be honest, in our world. A lot of times it seems like people would always step up and do things, you know, for people. I was actually, their grandson, who's a junior at Yorkville, was with us right next. And we were talking to him, and he said, if you're not going to pay someone, no one's going to show up. And I got to tell you, they've had plenty of people stopping over at their house saying, hey, we'll do it. $7,000 to $10,000 worth of, you know, labor they want to do it. But I do encourage you, if you have some time, again, Lucas, you was with us just yesterday. So even, you know, the younger ones, just come out. Any way that we can help, you know, they were extremely blessed and thankful just for the time that was given there. So we're going to do it again next Saturday from 10 to 1. Lee, do you have something?
I was going to ask today.
Okay, yes. So next Saturday, 10 to 1, we will also be getting, if you're connected through our email, you will see an email going out. And again, we're going to get some posts as well. Okay? Any other questions? Yes, Richard?
I think that right next to Marianne Matthews live.
Heard that. Is that they're related, right?
Brother and sister.
Yes.
And
Brandon, right?
Brandon, that's, but his dad is Bob.
Okay.
They must have got hit too.
No, they didn't. It's very strange because Kelly even said that. She goes, Brandon, you know, right next door, nothing. I mean, I actually went out to the property to see because that's in line with our property that we have for the church over there. I'm like, oh, please tell me the shed is still there. We just got done with that one. But we had no damage on our property. It just literally kind of bounced and hit right there. They have over 30 trees, like I said. It's quite a bit. They at least got the driveway so they can drive through. Any other questions regarding that? Yes?
Chainsaws?
Yes, so chainsaws would be great. Like I said, there's still more cutting. Rod, would you agree? Still some more chainsaw cutting to do out there? He was running a chainsaw for a good hour or two. So.
Pole saw.
Pole saw would be good, all right? So anything like that. Anything that you guys can think of, that would be great. Again, 10 to 1, look for an email, but it's right across from the college. You will not miss it right there. Yes, Julie.
I won't be in town, but I'm going to make sure you guys get some treats out there if anybody else wants to join them. I'm providing some treats for the energy you guys need.
Okay, so then Julie will provide some things as well. If you want to join with her on that, you can talk to her after service as well. That's what I love. I love everyone saying, hey, let's see how we can help out here. And like you said, hopefully we'll see if we can get the community involved. That's what a church to me is supposed to be about. It's about us all coming together in the whole community. We also, is that any other questions on that? All right, we're also putting out our pew pads. Please take some time, fill out your information, just check in. That would be great. And I think that's all the announcements we're going to cover today. Any other announcements? All right. With that being said, let's rise and pass the peace this morning.
Thank you.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Let us worship God. Let's join together in the opening prayer. Heavenly Father, in Christ you call us to dwell in your favor. We gather to praise you and worship your name. You are the rock that keeps us from falling, the Redeemer who can save us from sin. You set us upon the sure foundation of your commandments. You cleanse us from all unrighteousness through the gift of your Son. Accept our words as we honor your judgment, and be pleased with our worship as we respond to Christ's call. And you may be seated. I invite Bruce to come forward for our reading this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our scripture today is taken from John, 2nd chapter, verses 13 through 22. This is from the New Living Translation, and it's entitled, Jesus Clears the Temple. It was nearly time for the Jewish Passover celebration, so Jesus went to Jerusalem. In the temple area, he saw merchants selling cattle, sheep, and doves for sacrifice, and also saw dealers at tables exchanging foreign money. Jesus made a whip from some ropes and chased them all out of the temple. He drove out the sheep and cattle, scattered the money changers' coins all over the floor, and turned over their tables. Then, going to the people who sold the doves, he told them, "Get these things out of here. Stop turning my Father's house into a marketplace." Then his disciples remembered this prophecy from the scriptures, "Passion for God's house will consume me." But the Jewish leaders demanded, "What are you doing? If God gave you authority to do all this, show us a miraculous sign to prove it." "All right," Jesus replied, "destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." "What?" they exclaimed, "that it's taken 46 years to build this temple, and you can rebuild it in 3 days? But when Jesus said, "this temple," he meant his own body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed both the scriptures and what Jesus had said. This is the word of God for the people of God.
I invite all the children to come forward. Hi guys, how are you? Oh, did you hear that knee?
Someone might help me up.
Well, good morning. Everyone doing good? Yes, that's good. So, let's talk about something maybe that's a little bit gross. Is that a good idea? It's children's time.
No!
Yes.
I'm not a parent, not us.
So, question for you. Have you ever had a cold or allergies where your nose was all stuffed up and you had to breathe through your mouth? Yes, do you like that? No? No? Yeah?
Happens all week?
So is it passing around? A lot of, so we've all had a stuffy nose, right? Or runny nose, kind of different things like that. It's no fun. Do you like it being all stuffed up? Does it make you feel comfortable?
No.
No? Especially in your sleep? Do you snore then? You all like that? No, are you sure? Every so often someone wakes themselves up with a If her input sits, I mean, my note fits stuffy. All right, so why do you take medicine and blow your nose? To make you feel better? Why do you blow your nose? Come on. Lucas, what do you got for me? Why do you blow your nose?
You don't have to say the weird word. You just have to say something.
Get the stuff out. I said this was going to be a gross conversation.
Yeah, you don't want to say the word because it's disgusting.
It is. Okay. So next question for you. Does someone else usually, maybe a parent, give you medicine to take to try to help it out sometimes? Yes. Yeah. And it does help, right, a lot of times? What, cough medicine? Like the liquid form? I'm right with you. It's great. It gives you chills. It's a really good chill. Yep, medicines can be bad. So when a parent gave you your medicine, it helped. You blow your nose. Maybe they've helped you blow your nose. Have your parents ever helped you blow your nose? Huh? Saline? Do your parents ever take a Kleenex and put it to your nose to help you blow it? Not anymore. Probably when you were younger. Maybe even when you were a baby, they took the little nose suckers and sucked it up there. Felt like your brain was getting sucked out.
It was disgusting.
See, these are memories they're building for you guys.
Disgusting.
What's that?
Wait.
Oh yeah.
Nose?
So there's Frida. So it's a baby product now, and you stick the tube to their nose, and then there's a.
And you have to. Turn in my stomach. I think I'd stick with the little twitch of
it.
Okay. Who brought up this topic?
You!
Alright, so here we go. So thanks for letting us talk about a little bit of gross stuff. Hang on, let's move on. I think it will help us think about today's scripture reading. In today's scripture story, Jesus is starting his life in his work, his life's work, which is his ministry as he goes around. What Jesus did during his ministry was teach people how to better pay attention to God. Jesus also shared God's healing love with the people around him. One way to think about what Jesus did then is to say that Jesus helped clear things up. See, that's where blowing the nose all together. I wasn't just trying to. I was tying it all together. We got it. Now, that place was the temple. Hang on, Adam. There were all these things in the temple that were stuffing it up, that were keeping the people from being able to pay attention to God. So Jesus went and he cleared it up. You remember what he did? What did he make? Did you hear it in the scripture? No, he didn't make a paper. He did flip over the tables. Did you hear he also made a whip? This is the one time you hear about Jesus being angry. Now, sometimes our lives get stuffed up as well, just like the temple got stuffed up. And when that happens, we have a harder time paying attention to God, just like when our noses are stuffed up and we have a hard time breathing. But today's story reminds us that when we invite Jesus into our lives, then Jesus can help us get our lives cleared up. So in its own way, Jesus could be the medicine that helps us as well. This is one of the ways that Jesus helps us become better and to pay attention to God. That's the good news that we're talking about today. Let's go ahead and close out in prayer. Are you ready? Dear God, thank you for Jesus, who helps us clear up our stuffed up lives so that we can pay better attention to you. Thank you and amen. All right, you guys are ready to go. Yes, Ava, what do you got?
Why did you have to bring the notes?
Because I thought it would be fun.
You know what he's saying?
He'll be talking about it for a long time. That might be the highlight of the whole day right there. The pastor was talking about stuffed up noses. Well, good morning, everyone. So, question for you. Have you ever... All right, Katie, you could have done that up here. There's a prime example of your nose. That would have been perfect. Have you ever actually sat back and thought about your journey with Christ and maybe uttered these words? The church saved me. I was thinking back on my journey that has placed me right here, right now, during this time. And those words actually came to mind. You see, without the church, I wouldn't be here today. But the church that saved me, I realize now, is not just the building, but it was also those people that were part of the church to help guide me on my journey year by year. I learned over time that it was not going to be the building that was going to save me. To be honest, it wasn't going to be the people that were going to save me. Yet those things had everything to do with it. It was over the years that I learned to build a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And that is who saved me. So in a way, though, the church itself did save me. It didn't save me in the ways that you might expect, though. It wasn't a special Sunday service that saved me. It wasn't because of a great sermon one day that saved me. It wasn't because of a great music set. It wasn't because of a great mission trip. Those events, though, were all part of my story. But now I realize that God changed my life in small situations, step by step. And what I mean by that is that he did this day in and day out as I connected with him through all those things. It was when God became part of my life that my life was changed forever. And to be honest, it is still changing daily. Now, as a pastor, I remind myself that it was me, the individual, that committed to God, not the pastor for me. And I want you to realize that. You have to make your own commitment. No one else can do that for you. I hope that some of you that are here today, that are on your journey, I hope you are making ground and letting God in and being part of your life. Sure, you're here, and that is a step in the right direction. But I will be honest with you today. I worry about the future of the church. I worry about the future of the church and the children. It is your kids. It's your grandkids. It's your nephews. It's your nieces. It's your friends' kids. It's your neighbors. If you're a kid in this room, if you're a youth in this room, I worry about your friends as well. Let me ask a tough question. How many children, how many youth live in the homes surrounding this church, surrounding this community? How many are in bed or watching television or looking at their phones right at this minute? How many of them are not even aware of what goes on in a church? How many do not know that Jesus loves them? That there is a God, that they are of sacred worth, and there are people who care about them? I'll answer that question for you. There's tons of them all around here. I'm afraid for them, and I'm afraid for their future. We are watching our world crumble in front of us. We are watching their lives. Their lives are getting harder and harder, and many feel that they have nothing, that they have no value, that they have no worth. What can can we do to bring them in? If not their parents, at least them. I think this is our only hope for themselves and for us as well. The church helped save me. The people, they helped save me. And I got to remind you, I was angry at the church for quite a while. I think there are many people out there that are angry at the church. I know for a fact that the church itself is not perfect. No church is perfect. Hands down, that is a true statement. Churches, they hurt people. Churches have a lot of problems. And why is that? It's because churches are made of people. People with differences of opinions. That's why the Church of Jesus Christ actually needs to be honest and sincere in its quest to find out what it means to truly be the Church of Jesus. Now, I love the church. Jesus, he loved the temple from our reading today. He loved it so much, he refused to allow the temple to be anything other than a place where people find God. When Jesus entered the temple in our gospel reading this morning, he found very little in the way of love for God and for neighbor. Instead, it looked and sounded like an open-air market. Let me set that scene for you. The cattle were mooing. The sheep were bleating. The turtle doves were cooing. People were yelling. The coins were clanging together. These things had to happen in order for the temple to actually function. But it had become almost entirely corrupt. The temple tax had to be paid in the temple coinage. So money changers were a necessary part of what was actually happening. But the problem was, they were not giving people a fair exchange. They were ripping people off. Also, the people coming to the temple either brought their own animals for the sacrifice, or they could buy an animal from the temple. When you think about this, God had set the system up in order to aid those who traveled from a long distance. It wasn't supposed to be about making money. But who are we as a creation? Are we hungry people thirsting for more and more money? Back in those days, that's exactly what they were. To be honest, I don't think we've changed all that much. Money is a very important thing to many of us. Now, in any event, what had happened was that since sacrificial animals had to be without blemish, even if folks had bought animals outside the temple and brought them in, the animals had to pass an inspection. Due to the corrupt system, hardly any animals passed. So just about everyone had to buy an animal from the temple at outrageous prices. The temple had become corrupt. Greedy people were making money hand over fist at the expense of God's agenda. And let us remember, his agenda has not changed. His agenda is to help the poor, help those that are in need. We're talking about that tornado that just came through, to help those that are in need, to reach out to the least of these, practicing social and economic justice and worshiping God in spirit and in truth. That is what the church is all about. That's what the church is supposed to be doing. So what does Jesus do? He drove all this mess from the temple area and he said, "Get these things out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a marketplace." That's when he took a whip. He turned tables. Again, this is the only time you see Jesus himself very angry in letting this out. Now, because of this, the people couldn't celebrate Passover properly, and the temple lost a lot of revenue on that day. We could easily point fingers at the churches that preach the prosperity gospel. and seem focused on money, 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 thus getting the pastors rich. That could be a modern day analogy of what made Jesus so mad in the temple. But we all get this wrong one way or another, don't we? Now, there's not much point of bashing other churches. I think we actually need to just focus in on ourselves. What can we do better as a church? We have to ask those tough questions. Where do we fall short? Now, in any event, it should come as no surprise that the religious leaders questioned Jesus about his bold attack on the temple. They demand of him, they said, "What are you doing? If God gave you authority to do this, show us a miraculous sign to prove it." And Jesus answered, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up." Now, they take Jesus literally here. They're thinking about the 46 years that it took to build that temple, and it actually enrages them. They remember this exchange because in Matthew and in Mark, they tell us that this is the only specific charge they bring against Jesus at his trial. And of course, it is also thrown back in his face by his tormentors as he's hung on that cross and he dies. But Jesus is not talking about the physical temple here. He is talking about his body, his vessel. His enemies will seek to destroy him. They will think the deed is done, but this will not be the end. Jesus will rise from the dead, and the Jewish man crucified outside of Jerusalem will be raised to stand forever, actually replacing the temple and the system that was there. Now here's the thing. People will try and destroy him. It has not changed. We have people that will tell us, "You're a fool for believing in what you believe in." But ultimately, all of those efforts are in vain. I want you to keep that in mind. Churches may come and go, and at times it may seem like the church is sunk. We have so many buildings, huge structures, which were once filled, but are now nearly empty. Almost every church across every denomination is in rapid decline. I'm being honest with you. I'm being real with you. I'm not sugarcoating anything. These are true numbers that we're seeing. On any given Sunday, there are many, many more children out playing in their front yards, going to events, or sitting in front of the computer or on the phone rather than sitting in the church. There are many more parents who are sleeping in or working or playing rather than bringing their kids to worship to learn about God. We live in a culture that no longer values the church. We live in a very secular time. But this is not a reason to give up. Let's flip the script. This is a reason for us to actually get busy. Think about this. Where will these people turn when the going gets tough and things get dark in their lives? What other options will they know of? Will they have heard of this church here in this community? Are you talking about where you go, where you participate, the things that are happening that excite you about this church so they know where to go during those times? This is a reason to learn what it means to be the church and then do it well and do it with integrity. Live it. Be it. So others too can become part of this church and this community. The church is the only hope for this world. A world that is more lost and divided than it ever has been. But I want you to know this as well. You see, the early church, when it first started out, it also went through many struggles as they were being built and the story was being told. This is not something new, so don't lose your hope. Now, I know many years ago, I was wrong personally about the church. Jesus gave his life in order to save people through the church. You are the church, and I want you to keep that in mind. You individually, you are the church. And to be honest, you are a good one at that. A really good one. A church that has been part of this community for 136 years. I think we have a lot more to do in this community, the surrounding community, and throughout the world, right here in this building. So as I close out today, as we prepare to go to Holy Communion later today, let us remember, Jesus Christ paid it all. That God loves each and every one of us. And that means everyone, even those that are not here in this building yet. Who is missing from the church this morning? Do we know how important it is that they be here, that they be invited? Many times, the first time you come to a church is because someone invited you, because someone told you about the church. Do we know how important it is that we are here as well? What are we going to do about it? This church right here has saved many people over 136 years. Let's keep it going for the next generations to come. Amen.
Let's join me in at the cross.
Thank you.
As we go into prayer this morning, do we have any joys or concerns we'd like to share? Yes?
Maybe I'll learn to just start in this third round.
Okay. So we've been praying for Oliver. He's back home right now.
No.
Did he go back? Okay, so he is back in the hospital right now, starting his third round.
Yes.
So continue prayers for baby Oliver, the little over a year old. So please continue to hold him in prayer, hold his family in prayer. This is a very difficult time for this family. I can only imagine that. So let's be reaching out in prayer. Any other prayers or concerns? Yes.
Yeah, I guess I should, Linda would want me to share this joy with you that we had our seventh great grandchild on February
29th. Grandchild?
February 29th.
The seventh one on February 29th?
We did.
So I only have to get presents every 4 years.
Every 4 years, grandchild. You see? Always thinking the positives. Just got to do it every 4 years now. But they're going to have to be really big presents then. All right, that's a great joy. Any other joys or concerns? Yes?
One of my friend's mom was just recently diagnosed with lung cancer, stage 3, so just prayers for her and her family during this time.
That would be Brittany's mother. So, friend of Brittany's mother, do you happen to know her name or not? Okay, all right. So, prayers for a co-worker of Whitney's. Brittany, her mother, was just diagnosed with stage 3 cancer. Okay. Any other joys or concerns we'd like to share this morning? With that being said, let us go to silent prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, you've heard what's weighing upon our heart this morning. Lord, I ask that you be with us as we reach out to you in complete trust. Help us understand how you answer these prayers. At times with a yes, at times with a no. But I ask that you continue to let us be faithful and put our trust in you, Lord. Lord, we ask that you watch over all those that are here in our bulletin. Many of them dealing with cancer, we ask that you add Brittany's mother and her family to the situation as well, as she's been just diagnosed with stage 3 cancer. We ask for prayers for baby Oliver as he's back in the hospital right now, getting ready to start his third treatment. Be with him, be with the family during this challenging time. We ask for prayers for all of our military people that are away as we get ready to go into another holiday season. Be with them, thank them for the service that they provide. I ask that you continue to be with each and every one of us as we put our trust and our faith in you, Lord, knowing that you have just the best intentions for each of us. Let us also be thankful for the joys that we can have as we just went through a very tough week weather-wise, right here in our own community with the sirens going off, but yet there can be joy with the fact that even though right on a property that we know of, they lost well over 30 trees, that no one was harmed during this. that is a true blessing in itself, how it just skipped right over the house, but yet all around it, so much damage was done. We thank you for that blessing. We thank you for the joy of grandchildren being added to families. We thank you for the joy of birthdays that come up, the time that we get to spend together with our family, our friends. Lord, I just ask that you continue to be with your church here, to be able to guide us, to do the best that we can, as we've been doing this for so many years here in this community, that we have so much more work to do. Let us be able to reach out to those, to grow here in this community, to help these children, these youth, as they go through some challenging times, to help the parents, the grandparents, just everyone to know that you love each and every one of them, to be your hands and your feet, to be able to share the good word here in this community, to continue to bless others. We can do that through this church here. Let us remember that the church is each and every one of us that is here in person today, that is watching online. We are called to be your disciples, to show love and grace, to guide others on their journey as well. At one time or another, someone helped us on our journey. And let us be those disciples to be able to help others as well. And Lord, I'm thankful for this beautiful Sunday you've given us, for being allowed here in your house to be able to worship you, but most of all, to be with my brothers and sisters here, to be able to join together in a prayer you taught your disciples so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. At this time, we'll go ahead and take our offering. ask that you watch over your church, to be able to use these funds, to be able to do what it is we are called to do here in this community, the surrounding community, and throughout the world, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we'll go ahead and have communion. Communion will be served by intention, so you will come forward. I will hold the bread. Just go ahead and cup your hand. I will put the bread in your hand, and then you can dip it into the cup. If you need elements that are gluten-free, they are back here. They are non-contaminated as well. They're very sensitive, just so you know. Back here to pass that, and we will provide that as well. Let's lift up our hearts and let's give thanks to God. Blessed are you, O God, who with your word and Holy Spirit created all things and called them good. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us. Through Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead the same Jesus, who now reigns with you in glory, and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. On the night before meeting with his death, Jesus took the bread. He broke the bread. Said, "Take, eat, do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus then took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to the disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us that are gathered here today. Bless us and bless these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this juice, we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood, until Christ comes again in his final victory and we feast at your table forever. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. This table has been set. You may come forward as we go. silence. Let us remember what he was willing to do on that cross for each and every one of us. Let us remember that Jesus Christ paid it all. Please rise. Show grace to others and be the church. God bless and have a great week.